for November meeting?
There's a couple of things I just wanted to mention. They're not big issues, but if I could find them.
Go ahead.
On one, I guess on second page, all the way down, it said that I had stated that it should not be up to the landlord, and that word "not" should be eliminated. Okay. And in the beginning, Carolyn had stated that Deerfield Academy had agreed to donate money to the building of the MS. She said that they were going to donate the building, not money to it. I mean, it kind of sounds the same thing, but it's
No, actually, it's different.
Yeah, it is. We should have some clarity.
Okay.
So you're saying building?
Yeah, they're donating building, not money.
So I anything else? You got any other corrections?
No, just those.
I'd like to make a motion to amend the minutes as stated by Mr. Camosa.
Just one point of clarification. Is it up to that dollar amount that's been reported, or? No, okay.
They're doing the building.
There's no ceiling on it.
Right.
Okay, so it was
We got a motion on the thing. Hold on there, mister.
He's trying to
I'm trying to figure out what the motion is.
Just amend the minutes. Remove the word "not" and remove the word "money." It's build the building. But I think Carolyn did say the
I
money.
Think you're right.
I think she did say four. She said 400,000 or something like that at the meeting. But that's okay.
Are we okay on the amendment? Seconded.
Second.
On favor of the amendment.
Aye.
Aye.
What was the not one?
That was
on page.
It's
two.
A positive instead of a negative on that sentence.
Yeah. Which.
Tom, I'll give it to
third
you later.
Bullet point up from the bottom on page two.
Okay, yep, got it.
All in favor of the minutes as emailed and amended?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous.
Environmental town Sunderland.
What do we have for discussion on the building update from last month? Anything new that we need to?
No, everything is going forward. I don't know exactly what stage it's in. You know, from our end, the town's done everything that we needed to do to allow for this to happen, and we're just waiting for the academy to do their paperwork and come forward to the town for the different things they need to do, whether it be site plan review and stuff like that.
Good. Jonathan?
First of all, I appreciate moving the housing discussion up on the agenda. I have to leave probably around 20 of 7 at the latest, so I appreciate the opportunity to address this. You know, the town of Waitley has no interest in holding up a process if the board feels that going into the building that has been donated for construction by Deerfield Academy is the direction that it wants to take. I'm going to encourage this board to do what it feels it needs to do, because I don't want to be like many of the other people historically who worked to make sure that SCEMS didn't happen, because SCEMS is a great thing. I am saddened by the fact that, and this is present company in this room excluded, that many of the people who have fought so hard to make sure that the building is housed in Deerfield are the same people who fought so hard to make sure that SCEMS never happened. And that point is not lost on a number of people in Waitley. I guess my only request would be that before the board to think about the following, and if you choose to move forward without doing these things, well, that's fine. Again, I don't want to be the guy who hurts the existence of SCEMS. because there are people out there who would love to see SCEMS not exist. So I guess I'm going to just list a few of the things that I would like the board to consider before it adopted the building that has been graciously, very graciously supported by Deerfield Academy. I think that the board should have reasonable assurances that the funding is truly secured regardless of the ultimate cost that is realized. I know that we haven't seen any definitive cost estimates, and the reason I think this is important is most organizations have a pain point. And I would guess that Deerfield Academy has a pain point in terms of a budget, in terms of a cost to the building. And I think that before this board votes to move forward, as this is the plan, that we should make sure and we should see a plan where funding is secured to construct the building in at 100% cost. And again, it would include the final cost estimate to construct the building. And if it goes above and beyond the pain point, and I'm sorry if I use that term too much, but if it goes above and beyond the dollar amount that Deerfield Academy is comfortable with, some sense from the town of Deerfield as to where they are going to get those available dollars and see that it is passed at a town meeting, or debt exclusion, whatever process is needed to take. But I worry that if we go down this path without those assurances and then something happens, we're going to be left without a home for three ambulances for an indefinite period of time.
I don't want to interrupt. I just don't want to get too deep into this before I lose
response
to that. Okay, Jonathan. First of all, I don't think, but you can correct me if I'm wrong, that you're asking for Deerfield Academy to provide us with proof that they have funding to do this?
Oh, of course not.
Okay.
No.
The second point is that you said if they get to their break point, would the town of Deerfield step up and finish this? And the answer is no, because it can't happen that way. Because Deerfield cannot get involved with the construction of this building. It's entirely up to Deerfield Academy. They're going to start with it. They're going to do the plans. They're going to do all the submissions. They're going to complete it. When it's all done, they're going to give us keys. And that's the way it's going to happen. The school, the town cannot be involved with this process.
Why is that? I'm just curious.
We just can't, because if it's going to be a donation of a building, then they're going to donate the building. If they were, that's why I made the corrections in a minute, because if they were to give the town money and then toward the construction of the building, then the town would be building it, and that was would be in the difference.
Are we going to have a say on what we're getting?
What is it that you're looking? I mean,
I just want to make sure that it's going to be something that's going to meet all of South County's requirements.
If you're talking about this South County EMS facility requirement list that I got, no, it's not even going to come close to it.
You mean from the minutes? That list coming from the minutes that just...
I guess what I'm asking is, are we going to know what we're getting before we get it?
It will be substantially similar to the plan that I showed you.
That doesn't really answer my question, I guess.
Well, it will provide with... I don't have it in front of me, but approximately the 3,800 square feet, the three bays that are 16 by 40, the two bunk rooms to two locker rooms with bathrooms and showers, the three offices, and a common area room, for lack of a better description.
But are we going to see a plan before that
Yeah, they will have to submit a building plan, and I definitely can bring it to you. Okay. Yeah.
That's basically all.
And I guess I just think that if we know that, I'm trying to figure out how this board knows that is the direction we want to take before we see the plan. It's sort of like build me a house. Okay, you're going to build it. Fine. I want to see the plans before I know that this is the house that I want to live in.
Well, and I respect that, Jonathan, but I guess the way I'm looking at this is, you know, we're homeless, and somebody's willing to give us a house, we're not going to be too fussy. We need three bedrooms, we need two bathrooms, we need a good kitchen, we need this, and it's giving us all of that. So,
and again, I don't want to get into it, but I would argue that we're not homeless. We're looking to buy a house, and there are more than one. There is more than one house on the market, and so
they're looking to better the service
and at the best possible service. So to ask this board to say yes to a plan that we haven't seen, again, I'm not going to stand in the way anymore, but I'm hard-pressed to think that that's in the best interest of all three towns rather than just the interest of one town. But I'm going to keep going and leave that to you guys. But I'm hard-pressed to understand how you can sign a contract and you don't see the plans.
We're asking, I guess the town of Deerfield is just offering you a lease agreement. It's not a contract to build or to buy. It's just a lease agreement.
Right, and if I'm leasing a building for any number of businesses, I want to know that the building can satisfy my needs, both my current needs and my expansion needs. Otherwise, and if I and until I'm satisfied of that, I'm not convinced that my board of directors would be really happy with me.
Well, you know, I think that the building that's proposed meets and exceeds all of the requirements that were put out in that RFP. There's been financial planning done for our future expansion and maintenance and everything. It's all done. And so,
okay. The other thing that I think that we as a board should have as information before we sign on any dotted line, or say that this is our chosen path, is a timeline for construction of the building and an estimated occupancy date for SCEMS. So far we've heard, yeah, maybe, sort of, kind of, but there hasn't been a definitive timeline. I haven't seen a Gantt chart of when this is going to be constructed or when we can expect to move in. I do know that our contract with South County Fire, South Deerfield Fire District, is up at the end of June. And I haven't seen any guarantee that this proposal is going to meet our a timeline that we all have agreed many times is necessary to get three ambulances under one roof. Mm-hmm. So an occupancy date, I think, is a fair request. And again, I don't think we should do anything before that. And again, we've gone through, I do think that there should be reasonable assurances that the proposed building meets SCEM's current and long-term needs, making sure that we see plans where here is how the expansion would take place if this board chose down the road to expand, mm-hmm, because of demand for whatever reason. I'm also curious what additional costs SCEMS will incur because of the move, furniture, desks, file cabinets. What do you need, and what's the cost going to be? I think those, any additional costs, how that's going to be laid out. And I know this is going to be a sticking point, but this is at no cost to the town of Deerfield because of the generosity of Deerfield Academy. And the three towns will pay $36,000 a year for rent. I haven't seen what percentage of those dollars are going to be set aside for capital expenses. I haven't seen, assuming it's a town of Deerfield account, I haven't seen any assurances that we won't have to go through town meeting to get those, if we need a new roof or mm-hmm, paving, whatever those costs are. I see this as $36,000 going to the town of Deerfield, and then nothing that says that anybody but the town of Deerfield can decide whether the money is going to be released to the SCEMS use. Mm-hmm. And I think that's a problem. So in terms of what amount of the $36,000 a year in aggregate as years go by is going to be set aside for capital expenses, and where's our assurance that the political process that we all agree is a challenging process sometimes to get capital expenses done.
Yes, it is.
We shouldn't be subject to the whims of Deerfield Town Meeting, just like if the building had gone to Whately, you shouldn't have been subject to the whims of Whately Town Meeting in terms of, well, we're not going to, you know, where is the money earmarked? So, and then beyond that, I am going to let you go, Kip, but once we know what percentage of the 36 a year is going to go towards capital expenses, you know, the reality is that this is going to be a revenue stream for the town of Deerfield. It just is. It's a revenue stream to the town of Deerfield because capital expenses are not going to equal $720,000 over 20 years.
If you want to take some notes, it's going to be kind of broken down like this, and I use the word kind of because it's not good. $4,000 a year of the $36,000 will be used for maintenance, lawn mowing, snow plowing, things like that.
But that's going to be done by the town of Deerfield.
Not necessarily.
As a reimbursement.
Deerfield is going to take in the rent. And what you were just talking about, the capital expenses, exactly is something I've been thinking about this whole thing. And that's why the money is going to go into, and I correct me if I'm wrong, a stabilization fund or whatever fund it is. So that money is going to be for that building maintenance. And it's going to be broken down like this. $4,000 a year for, you know, the maintenance of the building parking lot. I'm not saying that the town of Deerfield employees are going to be plowing that or mowing the lawn. We might go out to a subcontractor like the fire department does. Because, you know, our town highway department, we have 6 people. We're stretched pretty thin anyways. Mm-hmm. It's $4,500 a year for the insurance on the building and $5,000 for short-term improvements and $20,000 for the long-term improvements. The short-term improvements are, you know, if you need to repair the grass or you want to paint lines on it, these types of things. Long-term improvements are, you know, 20 years down the road when we need a roof, or 6 years down the road when we want to add another bay. We're not going to have to go to town meeting and say, look, we need money to do this. The money's going to be there, and that's why we're setting it up this way. So it's not a revenue source for Deerfield at all. It's to maintain this particular building, and that's the way we're going to do it.
Okay. I think it's fair to ask for that in writing.
Oh, yeah, sure.
Sure.
Before we agree on the path.
And just so you know that the $4,000 for the maintenance, the $4,500 for insurance, and the $5,000 for improvements, after 20 years, that, if you will, stabilization fund would only accumulate to $400,000. So if we had to add on to a building, now it's no longer a gift. We're going to have to go through the same type of expensive procedure as, you know, any other thing. So it's not a huge amount of money, if you understand what I'm saying.
Well, you can put a new roof on $400,000.
Oh, definitely, yeah, definitely. Right. But you couldn't put a new roof on in another 30 feet of building.
I get that. And then I guess the only thing that I want, and again, I'm trying to avoid the use of the word tenant. And I say that because we are a partnership. Mm-hmm. We are a three-town partnership. We are not the tenant of the town of Deerfield. We are a three-town equal partnership. And so when the term tenant is used, to a lot of people, it is a feeling of you will do as we tell you to do. I'm just saying what the... If you want to roll your eyes, Kip, that's fine.
I'm not rolling my eyes. I guess that's a matter of personal observation. You know, people might feel like that, and I don't. I'm not going to argue that point. But you can't. I agree with you that the South County EMS is a partnership between the three communities. But South County EMS is definitely a tenant of that building. And you know, there's no other way to look at it.
Okay.
And
but we're a partnership.
And as Deerfield being the landlord and also being a partner in this group, you know, right from day one, I've tried everything that I've done, I've tried to make it as affordable and as equitable as going forward. You know, some of the things that you ask for tonight, I'm not going to say are totally unreasonable, right, if the procedure was a little different. But understanding how this is all coming about, it the timeline is just going to make it extremely difficult to try to meet that.
I mean, I haven't put out a timeline.
Well, yeah. All right, let me explain a little bit what I'm thinking. Is, you know, you say you want this board to see plans before we agree to do this. Well, by the time we get to see those plans, this is going to be in motion. And, you know, this board might say, all right, you know, we don't want to do this. That building's still going to get built. It's still going to get there. You know, okay. You know what I'm saying?
That's your call. That's, you know.
Well, no, it's not my. I mean, these folks are going to do this, and they're giving it to the town. So this building is going to go forward regardless of, you know, what this board wants. And no disrespect to the board, because I'm part of it, but the wheels are in motion to get this done. This is going to be a gift.
But let me ask you this. If, and I hope this wouldn't happen, but the SCEMS Board of Oversight gets the plans, and they're just not to the liking of who's ever sitting on this board at that time. And we say, no, we're not going there. The building's still being built. Mm-hmm. And correct me if my assumptions are wrong. What I hear is the town of Deerfield would create an ambulance service. And
that's
would
not
be,
what I'm
no?
saying.
No? Okay, so it would be for some other use.
It could, you know, I mean,
we'll make it work for SCEMS.
Well,
okay, but I'm hearing two different things.
No,
there, Trevor.
But there's the building's going
to
be built, and
stop
that
those wheels.
You know, I'm not so sure that in the future, and I'm not saying 2 years, 3 years, sometimes in the future, the ambulance service is going to be part of the fire department, and that's just the natural progression of things.
Wait, whose ambulance service is going to be part of what fire department?
Our ambulance service.
You mean the town of Deerfield's ambulance service?
Well, I think it might end up getting absorbed by that, because it's going to we're going to find out that if we're going to employ full-time firefighters that, you know, can be EMTs, and a lot of our current EMTs and paramedics are firefighters. Some of them, you know, aren't. Some of them are. But you can see that's how things go. I mean, that's how the larger cities do it. And as we start to grow the service, I can kind of see this going that way. Now, there's been no discussion about it. Matter of fact, in Deerfield, there's a huge separation about bringing the fire departments together. So, you know,
I was going to say,
that's what I'm saying.
You guys can't like even agree in the town to have one.
Exactly.
One department,
exactly. But
so.
But I'm just saying that this, you know, is what I see, you know.
That's your scenario. Yeah. Yes. So, personal scenario. Good luck to you.
Can I suggest a building subcommittee? Can we meet and talk with the people that are going to build this and say, you know, come to some compromise in between your sketch and Zach's? What do you mean, no?
This was done, and a budget was been set.
Yes, it was done pretty quickly.
If you're going to, and I don't mean you, but if there's going to be a change, that, all right, this isn't big enough, we need it twice as big, you know, it just won't happen then.
Actually, Mr. Chair, can I ask something?
Go right ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I thought it was interesting, Zach's comment that he sent to us, that he's looking for 6,500 square feet. Can we ask Zach to talk about that for a second? I just thought that was...
So
I didn't know how, because I didn't even see 6,500 square feet at the Whiteley Town Office.
I think there's been some confusion about what that RFP was for initially, and that was, the RFP reflected basically the total space that we are currently occupying across the four locations in the shared space, the shared kitchen and things like that. And that was for a move-in ready place. It was the two big problems that we have with South County right now that we need to find solutions for: operational difficulties, we're in four locations, and crew morale. And that's because they're crammed into space and they're in four different locations. The RFP was to find a space that solved the operational efficiency problem. We get everything under one roof, we get all of our drug licenses in one place, we get all of our security measures together, and we solve that problem. And then to solve the next problem was going to require more room. Room for the crew, room for the staff, room for a department of our size, which is equivalent to the Deerfield Police Department as far as personnel size goes. When we were talking about the RFP and we were talking about Whately, initially before the RFP, we had a notion that there would be options to expand or something like that as part of that. And when the RFP came back, it looked like there would have been some changes inside of the room, and that was at least my main concern about that RFP was, if we're going to discuss those changes and things like that, that those negotiations were beyond that response, and we need to address that. So to build a building for the RFP solves one problem, which is that consolidation problem. If this building gets built and we move into it tomorrow, as a department head, I'm immediately going to turn around and say, well, I'm going to need the other 3,000 square feet. That it's not a permanent home. That only solves one of our problems. So is consolidation better than how we are now? Yes, it solves one of our problems. But it doesn't solve my morale problem, my crew problem, or anything like that.
Why doesn't it? This is kind of new to me. We always talked about, can we as a SCEMS organization survive for 20 years living together? I think we all saw this as a permanent home. And I get your RFP. The RFP was one of the worst RFPs I've ever seen written in my life, having written a lot of RFPs. It was a disaster. So you have my sympathy on that. But I think we all saw this as wherever we went, this is a permanent thing. Or as permanent as you can make anything.
Well,
and morale, I guess I don't understand the morale thing. But.
Well, I know what the office building is, 12,000 square feet, about. It's 11,500.
Yeah, 11,500.
And I always thought that at the most, we were only getting like 4,000.
Yeah.
So what we're saying now is that Whately would never have been an option anyway. It's a long-term option. Because we would have never exceeded the 4,000 square feet. And that's the first I ever heard. I guess that's the first I've ever heard of that, Zach.
The information I provided in my report, it gave the move-in requirements, the long-term permanent requirements, and I've been consistent with that all along. And this isn't just my notion of what I would like. This is based on the HKT architects who provided this exact same thing back in 2010 when we were building the Deerfield Highway Garage. Deerfield EMS approached them and said, can we join together? Can we do something? And HKT architects said, okay, what's the size of your department? And that was Deerfield EMS. That was smaller at that time, but with that mission to grow. And they said, this is what you need for a department of your size. And they come to that. They actually come to a slightly larger square, 7,000 something. I went over to Highland. They just built a facility. They have two people 24/7, but only one full-time employee. And they only do 650 calls a year. They don't do intercepts or things like that. And they just built a 47,000 square foot facility. 4,700 square foot facility. And it's great. And Mike Rock's saying, this is perfect for us, but they still have provisions to expand up and expand out for the future.
Is that 4,700, does that include conference room or more so as a training area?
So there is a training area. They have two ambulance bays, and they have a training area. So
we have a training area next door in the fire station.
Exactly. So
one,
right?
So
Zach, just one second.
Yeah.
I've been trying to say for years, and Sunderland has done it. We have public safety complex. We have put fire and police together. Is it the perfect thing? Does each of those things, they probably would rather have their own stations, but I think it works for them. I've always personally, I think we build, and Kip and I have had this conversation, I think we build buildings for a singular purpose, and we forget that, like a senior center, most seniors, I'm not saying all, but most seniors are out between the times of daylight. And you talk to our town clerk, and she always has a problem we have voting, is about making sure there's enough light for seniors because there's a problem with getting around. So I always said, well, if we ever thought about building a senior center, why don't we build a community center so that during part of the day when it's going to be used by the seniors, or that they would be doing their thing, and then later at night we'd bring for meetings and stuff. So I'm a proponent of using sharing resources.
Absolutely. And okay, when I looked at Mike Rock's buildings and compared it to what I thought we needed, part of that was we don't need a meeting room as big as them because their department makeup is different and we have access okay to stuff. So those were all considered. My point is, for a department of our size doing what we're doing, if we really want to build something that is going to meet our needs and is going to be sufficient to hold the crew that we have, we're looking in the area of 6,500 square feet. And if we build something for 3,000 square feet, one, it's going to feel cramped on day one. That's fine, just to let you know. And two, there's 3,000 square feet that of space that the department will need long term that I'm missing there. And whatever the solution is to make up for that, I'm going to be fighting for it from day one. So I just want to make sure that everybody in this room appreciates that that 3,200, 3,800 square foot building, I feel is insufficient for the size of the department we're running.
Well, what I'd like to say is that, you know, from your figures, you know, you say you go out on 875 calls a year, and you've said that one ambulance can do up to about 1,000.
No.
No? Okay. What were those two numbers?
Because of where we are,
yep,
and we go out on 1,000 calls a year. We transport we see about 850 patients a year, and one ambulance, because of our demographics and our locations, can handle about 650 of those calls.
On your run call list, you had that, what was the terminology that used? Refusals. Does that mean you go to your call to my house and mm-hmm you get there and I say, I'm not that bad, you guys go home, and so you turn around and go back?
Okay. Correct.
So if you take that 181 away from your 181 from your 875, that brings you down close to 600 and something.
You can't subtract them like that because those calls still require resources, they still require time, those things.
I totally get that. But so in this garage that was proposed, you've got a vehicle that's 24 feet long, and when you park it in there, you've got another 18, 19 feet behind it, so you can pull out your stretchers or whatever.
Yep.
Each one of these bays is going to be 16 feet wide. Your ambulance is 8 feet wide. So if you take the difference, you've got almost 9 feet in between the ambulances. I find it confusing that you would say that's going to be cramped because you've got enough room to spin those gurneys around between the ambulances, back, not just behind them.
If the ambulance bays are built to accommodate an ambulance, the ambulance bay isn't going to be cramped.
That's not the issue, right?
That is not the issue. Okay. The issue is I have 9 full-time staff members occupying a 12 by 18
foot room. Well, how often are more than 4 there at any given moment, though, other than training?
Rarely.
Right.
But the point is every one of those person represents additional duties and office.
Right.
Like and files and all those things that, you would, okay.
But what I'm trying to address here is, I don't want to just say the whole thing. So the bays are going to be adequate for the ambulances. So we have, there would be 3 bays, and we currently have 3 ambulances, but primarily 2 of them run all the time. And the third one is just a storage.
Yep.
So then let's move into the other side. You have 2 bunk rooms for people to sleep, and then you have 3 offices. 2 of the offices are 10 by 12, and one of them is 18 by 10. So, I mean, there's enough room to, if you scale them out, you could have 12 desks in that area. And, you know, you basically have 4 people on, and they're not working all the time. I don't see how that's cramped.
These numbers that I've supplied are based on experts that have come long before me and my personal experience of over a decade and a half in this field. I've given square footage, I've given a breakdown of the rooms that I feel our department needs for long-term housing, and I'm not going to sit here and try to debate 10 by 12 versus 11 by 9 or whatever, but I put a lot and thought of research into these square footage numbers and these rooms and all that since 2014. And I'm just telling you, I stand by these numbers. We can disagree. That's fine. That's totally fine. I'm just telling you what my position is.
I'm sorry, Mr. Chair, could I just finish my thing? Because I do have to go, and I apologize. But I just want to make sure that people understand our perspective here. Just the final thing on this, you guys, is that, and I know I've said this many times, but I really do think it's important. I would like to see in writing that this building will be done, or I think this board should want to see in writing that this building will be done by prevailing wage. Because if it's not, it is breaking the law. And I'm not comfortable even being a tenant in a building that was built.
Well, I the only thing I can say to you, I would think with the resources that Deerfield Academy has and the money that they spend with the professional people that they hire, that they're not going to do anything that is illegal.
I understand. I want to make sure that they okay.
And not only the town council has reviewed this, Deerfield Academy's lawyer has also looked into it, and they've both come together. There's been a lot of discussion, a lot of debate, the whole nine yards.
Well,
and so
we went to the Attorney General's office, and they told us directly that this needed to be prevailing wage.
Well, I know Debbie, what's her name, really well at the AG's office, and you know, and
okay,
I even stepped back again, and I had to come. I have a letter.
I'm not going to argue about it. The board can do what it chooses to do. It's just a cautionary tale, and I'll show you the document that we have.
Bring it forward. And I guess it's probably how the question's asked. Also,
Public use building. But then I guess the final thing.
Public use building.
Public use building is not a gift, though.
It doesn't matter.
Do you have?
There's case study. There's cases cited.
Do you have it?
I don't have it with me, but I will send it to you.
Can you report it to all of us, please?
Yes, I will. The last thing, and I really do have to go, and I don't want this to be perceived that I'm walking out. I really do have to go. But this board needs to understand that the prevailing sentiment in the town of Whately is that we are not seen as a partner in this initiative by any stretch of the imagination. If Zach and his group weren't doing such a good job, there are a lot of people who would say, what are we doing here? Because we're seen as nothing but the third wheel. And this isn't just Gary Stone and Jonathan Edwards talking. Again, it has nothing to do with where this building's going to go. We don't want the building anymore, in no uncertain terms. But the town of Whately, watch our meetings. Nobody feels like we are a valued partner in this. And if we're not seen as by our townspeople as a valued partner, and I think there are a lot of people who think that because we're moving two of the ambulances, this does have to go to three town meetings because we're moving two-thirds of the housed facility right now. And I want this thing to pass, but there are a lot of people who just This is the Deerfield Ambulance Service and the towns of Sunderland and Whately. And again, I'm not saying that this is the sentiment in Sunderland, are helping defray the costs. And I'm going to encourage this board to really think about how that sentiment can be changed, because we don't feel like a partner. And I know I don't.
Well, the only thing I can say to that is that I have at least 35, if not 40, emails. And I've had probably that many phone calls from Whately residents saying they think it's a good thing to come to Deerfield. And I had many people from Whately tell me that they were very upset that Whately even bought that building. And that
I was one of them,
you know, but you know, it's so, you know,
yes, you were.
there's, they're not voted. They're voters in Whately, not in Deerfield. But, you know, I think I could easily muster up probably 150 people that would vote to move it to Deerfield.
Well,
and I don't go out.
If you can muster 150 people to come to a Whately
town meeting, I know.
I'm impressed.
But anybody's
town
meeting. Let's be careful about what we promise, because again, you got to remember the emails you receive are public records, and we can ask for them.
Sure. If you want me, I can bring them to you.
No, please don't dismiss the fact that people really aren't feeling valued.
Well, they should.
It's on both sides.
But you can't just say.
I'm not just saying.
Just saying it. Isn't going
to
help.
But John, it's a good point, because I'm sitting here trying to say, how would you feel like you're a valued member? I can tell you how you're a valued member, okay, very easily. Town of Deerfield couldn't run the system without us.
Right.
Because of the dollars.
Right.
Right, that's the value.
It's not just the dollars.
No. Again, Trevor, I'm not just saying this.
First is the dollars. But the second, they don't have enough runs to justify a full-time service as it's constituted.
I understand
right now.
That.
But the
decision making seems to be driven by Deerfield.
How is that different than what goes on at the Frontier School Committee? How do you feel?
I painfully don't watch those.
But how do you feel? It sometimes, especially now with the weighted vote at Frontier.
Which is unfortunate, but yeah.
Okay. It's even more so. And right now, one of the, I thought the forethought of putting this group together, to the chagrin of some in the town of Deerfield.
Was two and two. Couldn't agree more.
I think what that does is that shows that at the time, and I hate speaking well of Deerfield, but I have to at this point. But I think at that time, they recognized the fact that the only way to make this thing happen was that we were equal partners.
And I agree. I'm just saying that the actions, again, it's not just me, Tom.
You and I have known each other for a long time, right? And I take what you say very seriously. I respect you tremendously. I think just the makeup of our board shows that, and I know there's people in Deerfield that vehemently disagree with the makeup. They think they should have a greater. And I will say.
And we told them to bring them on.
That's the thing that binds us together, because we are dependent upon one another.
Jonathan, I'm probably not going to make you feel any better, but I get as much grief. Different direction from my community too. There are people that
I get that.
You know, so
there.
I mean, there
are people who. I don't know whether it's a fair assessment or not. I could see it both ways. That if, and you have to understand, there are people who really believe this. If this board had followed through on its previous vote to go to the town of Whately. And you have to and the reason it did not, part of the reason was because of pushback from the town of Deerfield, that if we had continued with that, there would have been a tremendous amount of pressure for Deerfield not to do it. That's the sentiment in Whately.
It could have been.
Well, they
just weren't going to do whatever.
That could be true.
And that was done. That was spoken on town meeting floor.
But that could be true. But on the other hand, you have to at least consider the fact that if the attitude of Deerfield, some of Deerfield residents were so opposed to this, it could have meant this thing imploded.
Right, but that was 30 people.
I mean, those are the people
who were against the thing to begin with. Same people.
Wheel gets to grease.
What's that?
Wheel gets to grease.
I got to go. But, and again, you guys vote the way you want, but I would strongly encourage us to
work on these things.
Listen to this before we are so far down the road that we have no options.
I thought we had a motion on the table anyways. Didn't you say something, Mr. Chair?
No.
Oh, yes, you said something. Weren't you talking about a building committee?
Oh.
I said, why can't we have a building committee to look at the plans and see if it's something that everybody wants? And Kip says, too late for that, because they already decided what they wanted.
You can have a committee, Bob, but I think it would be a waste of time, because you know, these people aren't, you know, they were sold on an idea.
Your idea.
Right, not ours.
You didn't take anybody's, you took your own idea and rolled it, and you did a great thing. You just didn't get any information from the rest of us.
Well, you know, you've got the choice. I mean, if the board wants to vote, we'll do it.
You had the choice to do what you did. You didn't ask us, and you just did it.
Yep. But it got done.
It got done.
No.
We were doing stuff for the last 2 years, but you just did what you wanted to do.
Well, I'm sorry you feel that way.
Could I ask a question?
You're doing a great thing, but you didn't ask anybody's input. You just wrote down on the thing because you're...
That's not true. I read the RFP, which I agree was poor. I talked with Zach, got some input, not his final thing, but I just got input. I took a look around what was going on, what they need. I went to the open houses at Whately to see, you know, what was going on there, what was proposed, and I put it all together to make, you know, it work.
Well, don't forget that RFP was written by the town of Deerfield without our input.
It was a disaster. I admit it. It was.
Is it possible to accept this building, what they give us, and then come together as a board and decide to do more if we want to? I mean, we're going to have to, we may expand at some point, but isn't...
The whole idea to go with Deerfield Academy was to save a bunch of money.
Well, I think it is.
And
I
now
mean,
we're
going to
put in that money.
Well, I don't know. I mean, I think
to give
if
us
you're,
what we want.
If you're getting, you know...
We don't know how much extra...
7/8 of the...
Or... What extra is going to cost? Because we don't.
We still do need to put, like, desks in and all the radios and whatever else goes in an EMS building. Correct.
Yes.
So we've got to get some figures on that. And that's going to be an expense of ours. But if we take, you know, so it's two-thirds of the cookie or whatever we get for free, and with the. To expand, if everyone's cramped in a year and they got to have another meeting room or three other bunks or something, or I don't know about another bay, but I just think it would be great to get what we can get and then move forward.
Yeah,
I haven't attended every meeting, but attended several meetings with the SCEMS board, but also with the select board in Deerfield, and I've also watched some Sunderland Whately meetings and that. And to be honest, I'm a little disappointed with the number of square feet we're talking tonight, because I remember very clearly that I saw a set of plans that Mr. Camosa did up and supposedly had spent time with Zach, and Zach was there, and they had reviewed those plans. Now, I'm not saying Zach gave the stamp of approval, but it was pretty much understood that, what was it, 36 or 3,800 square feet was kind of the number that everybody was looking at. And all of a sudden tonight I hear, well, no, we need 6,000 square feet. It's like, where did that number come from? I'm sorry, and I'm not trying to offend anybody, but it's like, that's the first time I've heard this number come out where all of a sudden, oh, we need this. Well, that's like a bait and switch. You know, the effort was made to approach Deerfield Academy, and they're gracious enough to more or less grant a wish here. And I wish Jonathan was here because I think, and I don't want to misspeak here, but I think Deerfield Academy is making an effort to respond to some of the concerns that some of the Deerfield residents have about stuff being taken off the tax rolls because of property purchases and so on and so forth. And whether that's fair or not fair, you know, from what I'm viewing is that they're trying to make a very generous effort to address some of those concerns that Deerfield residents have. And here we have a building that's being offered, and Deerfield's willing to share it with SCEMS as far as basically a no-cost building. There's going to be rent involved, yeah, but they've already said that they're going to try to earmark that rent for capital improvements over the years and that's a win-win for all three towns. Plus, it's at a lower cost. Now, as far as the numbers, with Zach's concerned about square footage, let's get the main building built. And then over the years, because we are building hopefully a capital improvement fund, we can address those future concerns. And if there's a need, then we do it. You know, we do do a addition. If there isn't, then so be it. And I know, Zach, you've run numbers and, you know, with the experts and so on and so forth. It just, let's face it, everybody's got a wish list, and we all want the Cadillac. We might not be able to start off with Cadillac. We might have to build up to it. We might have to buy the Chevy first and work our way up, just like when you started off when you were a kid.
I think we've been pretty consistent with what we were asking for, and there was kind of a fast track to get the plans made and Deerfield Academy to grant it, and Deerfield Academy is doing a great thing. I agree with you. Some of your statements are not correct about the square footage and working together with Zach and getting, you know, there's a disagreement there of how much we need. Maybe Zach's 6,000 square feet or whatever it was in his request, maybe he's not going to get that, but there's a few things in there that need to be added.
It is true. When those plans came out, Zach did say at the end of that meeting that this would be okay to get in, but I'm going to feel tight. I'm going to want to expand, and you know, so that probably everybody didn't hear that, but I do know he brought that up at the end of.
Yeah, the meeting. It's an issue of, like I said, the two problems I see that this department needs to find a solution for, and
right.
This is a solution for one of those problems. And when presented as, you know, is this, I know we're looking for a place we can move into tomorrow, will this do? And it's like, it needs some work, but it solves one of those problems. Absolutely. Thinking about a permanent home now, you know, you're absolutely right. I think your car analogy is, if I just need to, you know, I crash my car, I need some wheels. Yeah, whatever works. But if I'm going to make an investment in my future and think about those things, you know, then it's like, okay, well, maybe that minivan is going to be a better choice than that coupe that's on the lot, and you know, what's most appropriate. So.
As a Deerfield resident, I was wondering whether or not the building that is being proposed can be expanded to 6,500 square feet.
Could it be?
Sure.
It's easily expanded. Wouldn't need to encroach on any other additional uses that the town has planned for that property.
The town doesn't have any other plans for it. Well, there's been talk about, you know, because it was supposedly given for recreation, but I haven't heard any serious conversation about it.
So you could build a building that you could increase by 40% just the building itself without the bays.
I think that there's 5 or 6 acres of land there, so you know, and there's some questionable wetlands off to one area, but I mean, we're hundreds of feet away from that, so.
I would just be concerned, because I don't think we could build that big a square foot highway garage on that site.
Well, I think our highway garage was 13,000 square feet.
The way it's proposed now, before it wasn't. It was close to 8.
That was tight. And one of the big things, in my opinion, is that what drives a lot of this thing is it really does come back to dollars and cents. You know, it really does. In that, you know, although, you know, the ambulance service is one of the most critical services that we have in a community, you know, by no means is it the only one. And, you know, there's so many things coming, especially in Deerfield, to have this opportunity not to have to have, you know, more taxpayers' dollars go with this. It's an easy thing to say, well, you know, you're going to have to live with this and not mean it in a mean way. It's just like, you know, all the things that are before a community to pay for, you know, and you get an opportunity like this, it's like, you know, it needs to be addressed as seriously as the service itself.
My last comment, and I agree with you, Kip, but I don't think SCEMS as a commission or group would be able to afford a 6,500 square foot building. I don't think the towns would want that, just personally. The cost of that size of a building would be more than the town people would be able to pay.
It's just like when we talk about the library in our town, it's not just, you know, it's a bigger building, but then now it costs more to heat, it costs more to insure. You know, there's a lot of things that go along with that, too.
The only thing I can say is that 6,000 square feet, that's 6,000 square feet next door to us.
I know. I'd love to walk
through with anybody, and someone has to show me how we need a building of that that size next door. I'll disagree with a couple things. A, morale. I work in manholes that are 140, 150 degrees. And my guys go in them every day. And they have little crap holes to live in for a desk. And you're talking about having a 10 by 12 office, an 8 by 10 office. You're having bunk rooms. You got showers. Zach, I'm sitting over here and I'm appalled that you're telling me that you don't have enough room.
I think one of the things that Zach's trying to explain is a lot of these people work for other departments who have that bigger space. And it's going to be hard to recruit these people, you know.
I would say that, and again, to me, I don't care. I'm appalled. If you don't want to come to work in a 3,800 square foot spot that has new furniture, has the amenities that there has, you got, you're working in an ambulance. How many other places have an ambulance where you sit down the entire time and you got 6-point hitched into the thing so you're not subject to injury and such? How many of those? Jack, how many of those do you know? Are there a lot of those out there?
I'm serious. Do you see a lot of those? What's your question? That are new ambulances up to safety specs?
I'm saying, how many people
specs?
Are working in ambulances right now that you're sitting down with a 6-point harness and that they don't have, everything's within 3 feet of them? How many of those are your people working in ambulances like that right now?
Any new one coming off the assembly
how
line?
How many are, I'm asking you a question.
I don't know, like, what so question
what
are
saying,
you asking?
What I'm saying, when you talk about morale, if you're telling me that you only can name, that morale is based solely upon, you're going into a brand new building, and you're telling me you can't maintain morale in a brand new building of 3,800 square feet?
I'm saying my two biggest concerns right now in the department, and one of them is housing,
and one of them is living conditions, and I'm trying to accommodate that. We should just dissolve this. Because if you're trying to tell me that 3,800 square feet or 4,000, which Whiteley was only 4,000 square feet, you're telling me that that's not enough, maybe then we shouldn't even be in this business. In my opinion. And I am the biggest supporter of a South County EMS from before South County EMS. But if you're telling me 4,000 square feet is not enough, why am I here? How can you afford that?
My point all
what
along
is your point?
Has been, I've provided numbers, and the 3,800 square foot is appropriate for us to move in and operate out of. It represents the amount of space that we have right now. That totally works.
And
from an operational,
you're saying 38, and I'm saying you're probably closer to 4,700 square feet because you're not talking about the training area next door that you have in the
okay.
South Deerfield Fire
okay.
Department. So you've got more than 3,800 square
sure.
feet, don't you?
Appreciate.
So let's don't say that 3,800. Let's say more like 4,500.
Okay. So then, looking forward for a long-term department of 8-9 full-time staff members are there 24/7. All the time, and we're looking to expand.
That we're running two people at a time.
What we're doing, be
two
it
people at a time.
Outreach, AED training that Deerfield has requested, things like that. Looking towards the beyond with four
here.
Ambulance
I
space.
Want to dissolve South County EMS right now.
No second.
I can't believe you're saying this. This is the most amazing thing I've ever heard. When I read your email, I looked at that email and says, really? 6,500 square feet? It's bigger than the Sunderland Town Library. 6,500 square feet, Zach.
Almost 4,000 of that square feet is for vehicles. So I'm talking about, look, I appreciate what you're saying.
No, you don't.
I'm trying to be an advocate for the staff, my service, and looking towards the future.
And you also have to advocate for the people that paid the tax dollars in our communities.
Appreciate, and I'm one of those people. I
understand
appreciate
that.
That.
You have to advocate, and that's a tough point. You have to advocate for those also.
Okay.
And there's a lot of people out here, A, that go to work in much worse conditions.
they're working in trucks that are 20 years old to plow the streets and towns of our thing, and our town, and there's people that go to work every day that are working outside in the cold, and they're working in holy pants, and they're climbing up the sides of buildings. I've never been so disappointed in my entire life as I'm right now. I have never been. This to me is appalling. You want 6,500 square feet, and we're going to have morale issues if we don't get it. I've said enough.
Well, you know, I understand your frustration, but I think that, you know, I'd like to turn the tide a little bit and say, you know, we'll continue working on the housing that's proposed, and if we all agree, then we go forward with that. And that I'm sure that Zach will make it work. And down the road, if the need comes for a bigger space, you know, then we can add to the building. But for now, I feel very confident that, you know, everybody that's going to be in there is going to have more than enough room. But it does kind of have a segue right into, you know, the labor aspect. And, you know, if you brought it up about morale thing, I earlier in the week I went to Zach and I wanted to see the schedule for the month of December, you know, a few weeks prior and going forward. And I noticed that what he told me is that every paramedic and EMT that works the second and third shift, they're always 16-hour shifts. And that seems to be an awful lot. But it's not like that just on the weekends. It's like that every single day. And I have a concern about these people getting burned out just from working so many hours. And that, you know, now, and that kind of brings me into the whole, you know, the sleeping quarters and stuff like that. If these people have been on call, you know, and doing whatever they do for 10 or 12 hours, then they go and fall asleep for an hour, and then I call them to my house. I mean, what kind of condition are these people going to be in when they get there? You know, and I think when I feel that I'm paying somebody $36 an hour to do this, I don't necessarily want them to be sleeping or just woken up when they have to come to my house. And I think that, I don't know if that can be addressed with, you know, per diem people or how that works, but I don't like that. Every single day, it's a 16-hour shift for these people. Now, I did see that they'd work for 2 days, and they have a couple days off, then there is 2 or 3 days. Is that how it goes?
So there's a lot of evidence that shows shift work is very detrimental to staff long-term and short-term health-wise. And if you schedule ambulance crews for like 8-hour blocks, like a typical 5-day, 8-hour workday, for your large-scale systems that are doing calls back-to-back, they typically do shift work. So you come in at 11 p.m., you work till 7 a.m., but you're up the entire time, right? You're doing transfers, you're doing shifts, things like that, and then you go home and you sleep. For a service, like a 911 service that typically has lower call volume during the night, because that shift work is so detrimental, asking people to come in at 11 and stay up for 8 hours, they tend to get other jobs. They tend to do other things during the day. So they actually come in more tired, and they're more tired while they're staying up. So you expand the length of the overnight shift, and you allow for rest and sleep. And that's typically how emergency 911 services work. So the idea being that if they go to bed at 9, 10 p.m., and then you call at 3 a.m., yes, they are woken up from a sleep, but they're actually in a better position to be able to care for you and think critically than if they were to be awake, come in at 11, and have stayed up until for those 4 hours until you called.
They typically sleep prior to going to work. But anyways, I don't know this, so I'm asking, is it true or not true, as far as you know, towns like Amherst and Northampton don't always have people work 16-hour shifts, and that they, if people do work for their departments, they don't want them to work somewhere else prior to coming to their place?
They typically work 24-hour shifts, 24 on, 24 off, 24 on, and then 5 days off. And they're expected that they will sleep and rest during the eve hours for the reasons why I just told you. You know, Amherst actually used to do 10 and 14-hour shifts, and they actually fought, the union fought, for the 24s because it was better to work and sleep and have a longer duration of period where they can rest.
And now they wish they didn't because they're getting their butts kicked because Amherst is one of the busiest towns around and they all do 24-hour shifts.
But are all of the people that, I don't know, how, I'm going to, if there were a half a dozen people that work there at any given time, are they all sleeping at the same time?
Yes. Or? Yep. So they're all in tours just the way we are.
I don't think it's like sleeping home in your bed because they're sleeping dressed if they can get to sleep at all with the radios going and...
It is something that we had discussed in the past because as you go forward, you've got to compete with that market to attract people to come work here. And granted, to Tom's point earlier, it's a lot better conditions working in Deerfield, Sunderland, Waitley than it is downtown Springfield. For a new medic who wants gunshots and stabbings, yeah, it's downtown Springfield. But for a seasoned medic who's been out there for a little while, the first time you've got to take somebody who's larger, my size or larger, down six flights of stairs because the elevator's broken on a cold, icy night, you very quickly learn, I really don't want to be working in a town that's got six floors in their buildings.
Because so, they all are on their third floor.
Yeah. You've got a whole different, you get a different clientele, different problems that you're going to see here than what you see in Springfield. Springfield, you see gunshots and stabbings. In Deerfield, Waitley, and Sunderland, you'll see farm equipment accidents.
I have a question. Census was brought up about staff. I was just wondering, the staff that we currently employ, do they work other paramedic positions for other towns?
Most firefighters and paramedics have two jobs.
So they work 40 hours for us and maybe 40 hours for somebody else?
If they choose. We can't stop them from doing that.
Restrict that.
Some of our full-time staff do maintain part-time paramedic jobs elsewhere to keep their skills sharp.
Police.
Exactly, right. But then all of our per diems, they have full-time jobs elsewhere because you have to in order to maintain your
certification. Makes sense on per diem, but
yeah.
Full-time
yeah.
Staff, I think if you can't live on 40 hours a week, maybe we're not paying a lot of money.
Well, a lot of fire EMS jobs, they'll work, like he was saying, they worked a 16-hour shift and then they have two or three days off, so they pick up a part-time job somewhere.
The part-time is not a problem, right?
Yeah, I don't know if they're actually working 80 hours a week or not. Yeah, I'm not sure. That's a lot.
They limit truck drivers so you can't drive that many hours a week just for a particular reason. And, you know, that's
why some of them run two logbooks. Any new truck's got a computer in it now, though. Gary, anything new coming under housing?
Yeah, I just want to put my sentiments out there as far as the location. I believe we're on the wrong side of the tracks, for one thing. We're not central to the three towns. Since this thing had started, we had a lot of discussion as far as the location being central to the three towns. And seems like since Deerfield Academy is paying for a building, it seems like that issue has gone away and nobody seems to think it's an issue anymore. Deerfield Fire Station is the ideal location for Deerfield, not for the other two towns. I still think that with the trains are always talking about increasing the train volume going up and down these tracks. I think that's going to be a big issue down the road. Right now, if they go into South Deerfield Station, which is what's being proposed, then yeah, it doesn't affect Waitley because you got right down 5 and 10. You don't have to cross the tracks. But I'm concerned about the other towns going to Sunderland or even the center of South Deerfield.
You don't need to cross the tracks to go to Sunderland.
Why not?
Go down Route 5, take a left on 116?
If you take 116, yeah, or if you go through the center of town.
You wouldn't go through the center of town, there's too much traffic.
Well, about the center of South Deerfield.
Well, center of South Deerfield, yeah.
I'm just saying that, you know, that doesn't seem to be a concern anymore for some reason. Well, I know what the reason is because of this. I just don't think that Deerfield is considering the other two towns as equal partners in this endeavor, and they're looking at their best interest for South Deerfield.
Well, that's, let me tell you what I did. I looked into three different properties in the industrial park, to put it there. I looked at two parcels of land, one that's owned by the town and another one, or take that back, from the water district, another one that was a private landowner. I also looked at another parcel of land in Waitley where the old Fox chemical place was, and I also looked at the land that's near the truck stop, and none of them were available, you know. It was really difficult. And even though the South Deerfield location is a mile away from the truck stop, I think one of the big benefits, and I don't know how well it works, is the ambulance has the ability to stop the traffic lights. So I think that's a benefit. I mean, granted, it is a mile further from Sunderland and Waitley's main hall, but with being able to control the traffic lights, it has a big impact on it.
Board wasn't aware that you had checked into all these other places either. You know, I mean, we started this whole service. Each town had their own ambulance, and we wanted to better that, so we started the regional service. Well, now we're going to be stuck in one location, which is not bettering it for Waitley and Sunderland, the way I see it. It's bettering it for South Deerfield, but not for the other two towns.
Well, I think from my viewing of the service, what I liked about it anywhere in that general area is that, you know, instead of somebody being at home and getting a call and having to drive to their local fire district or department to pick up the ambulance, then go off, we have people right there to do it.
No,
so even though that fire truck or ambulance is further away in Waitley, the response time is going to be probably quicker. I mean, if there was somebody at the Waitley Inn who needed an ambulance today, it will get there quicker than it used to from Waitley's, and their fire station is only a mile away.
I'm not disputing the fact of what we had compared to what we have now. No, yeah, we have 100% better than what we had.
And then some.
Just, disputing the location, that's all. So
I
realize it's too late, and that's my say on it. And I just want to know, let everybody know that I'm against it.
I think the board of Deerfield, selectmen of Deerfield, should strong arm Dedek and get it right into the industrial. Use some muscle there, Trevor. Just like TJ Ward did the other day against Edelman.
I'll stick you right on the minutes. Or the agenda.
Oh,
director's report and budget.
Can we move on to the director's report for some.
Sure.
News?
Good news.
For some levity?
For some news. News of the past month.
All right. So I kind of show what we do as paramedics, what we're capable of doing. I pulled out this particular case study. This isn't the only one, but this was one of the more recent ones, and I had some recent data. We get reports back from the hospital on every single one of these calls. And this is a local patient who, 80-year-old male, that's as much as I can say, who experienced chest pain late at night. It was 11:16 p.m., called 911, and our crews got on scene, I think it was like 6 minutes on scene, and they started their 12-lead EKG in under 10 minutes, which 12 is what we're shooting for, under 12. So under 10, they got the EKG, and based on what they saw in the EKG and the patient's complaints, they made a decision to take that patient directly to Bay State Springfield. So why is that? When you have a specific type of heart attack, or any really heart attack, the only real treatment for that is to make those arteries in your heart open again, right? So you get a heart attack because your arteries close, You stop getting blood flow, you stop getting oxygen, and your heart muscle actually dies, heart attack. So they need to reopen those arteries. And there's a cardiac catheterization lab at Bay State, and that's the only one in Western Massachusetts. So any patient who shows up at Cooley or at Franklin who is having a heart attack, they actually have to go to Bay State for it. And there's a very small window, it's about an hour, that they want you to receive this treatment. So in the past, as a BLS level service, we would have taken that patient, thrown them on an ambulance, they have chest pain, we throw some aspirin at them, and we take them up to Franklin. And you know how long it is to get, you know, registered at a hospital and stuff like that. So finally you get in a bed, they put the EKG on you then, and they figure out, oh, you're having a heart attack, you need to go to Bay State. So they have to call an ambulance. So the ambulance has to come to the hospital, pick you up, and drive you down to Bay State. And all this meant that 3, 4, 5 hours until you're getting the treatment. Now as paramedics, you get that EKG not in the hospital room, but right at your bedside. So that's what our crews did. That person called 911, they went in, they put the EKG right at the bedside, saw that that individual was having a heart attack, and said, we're going to take you straight to the cath lab. En route, our equipment, our advanced cardiac monitors, we can actually send, it's kind of like a fax, we can send our EKG directly to the cardiologist in the cath lab before we even get to the door. So they can start making judgments. My report, this says not for patient diagnosis, that because it's a printout. Our actual ones are for patient diagnosis. They're the same, if not better, than what you get in the hospital.
So was imaging just done on the ambulance as well? The images?
Yes. Yeah. So they see it right on the machine, and it prints out, and our paramedics are trained just like a cardiologist to interpret that. And because of the paramedics' level of training, they actually totally bypass the emergency room at Bay State. And they get whisked right up to the cardiac catheterization lab. The cardiologist meets them at the door, and the paramedic gives report to them. And so this individual, I don't know if I can pull it up quick, but on the next page on my report, and these will be available for the audience members, you can actually see this is a real-time X-ray with contrast dye. It's the exact same view, and the one on the left, there's a little arrow, and that's the artery, the right circumferential artery, the RCA on the heart that was totally occluded, and everything that artery feeds, that like the entire side of a heart was dying. And then they gave them the treatment, and you can see in the second photograph all the blood that was returned.
Was that imaging done in the ambulance as well?
No, this is in the cardiac catheterization lab. Part of our continuous quality improvement to make sure that we're always doing better is that we actually get reports back from Bay State. So every time we have a case like this, Bay State gives us all their information and their CQI and says, this is how well we did, and it's largely in part of because of what you did, so we get to compare and contrast notes. And I don't know if you can see it, that we lose kind of generations here, but on the front page, this 12 lead EKG, if you look down in the bottom left, there's a Roman numeral 3. Mm-hmm. Each of these 1, 2, 3, AVR, AVL, AVF, V1 through V6, are electrical views of the heart. So we put all these stickers on your heart, and the paramedics are trained to interpret the electrical activity from each one of those views. And each one of those views represents a specific part of the heart. So lead 3, in the second image, the kind of the larger one, you'll notice that second hump is a little bit bigger. That is what clued the paramedic in. So the paramedic saw that hump, measured how many millimeters that hump was larger, and was able to diagnose the heart attack because of it. So huge success story. And not only is it the type of thing where it's potentially a life saved, but even a quality of life. That in the past, these people would spend so much time getting in the catheterization lab, their hearts were, you know, only half working at the end, and they couldn't do any sort of, you know, lifting from that point on in their life. There's a non-flattering term we use in the medical field. It's called cardiac cripple, which means you're alive, but your heart really can't handle much more than a sedentary lifestyle. But because we can do this now, and we can take them to the cath lab, we can prevent those types of things from happening. So a lot of these people now are leaving the cath lab the same, if not better, than they were before. So,
that's awesome.
Yeah, pretty great stuff. So, great news. Our full-time paramedic, our latest hire, Teresa Emerson, has accepted the position. Her first full day will be December 27th, right after the holiday. She'll have 2 weeks of orientation, so she has to get trained on our equipment, and our medical control physician has to approve her. But we expect that she'll be right into the rotation within the first, within like 2 weeks.
Can I ask a question about that?
Yeah.
I noticed with a couple weeks ago when the Deerfield Board approved that hire, one of the concerns that I had is that, you know, we went with your recommendation for the higher pay, but because she gets paid more than other people have been there, how does that deal with morale?
Well, so part of that segues right into what I'm about to say. So we have a mentor group, which is some of my most experienced and well-versed paramedics, and they volunteer a lot of their time right now to do those duties. We're all hoping that with the new personnel classification study that is happening in Deerfield, that we'll have the ability to recognize ability and things like that, efforts and stuff like that, instead of just this typical, you know, every year you get your 80 cents that, no, you're putting in extra duties, you're going above and beyond. I'm also hoping that that classification study will have appropriations for, you know, either a supervisor or mentor type stipend annually or something like that to recognize these extra duties as well.
We knew that this hire was important to you and to the service. When I say you, I don't mean you.
Yes, right.
To the service. So we debated it for a while, and we were reluctant about approving it for the same reason I think where you're approaching, is that now we have 8 other people are going to be putting their hand out and say, hey, you know, she just came here, mm-hmm. and she's getting this. How come we're not? You know, we've been doing this. Mm-hmm. And we've left that up for you to deal with. And
yeah, so, all right, absolutely.
Don't turn to us and say, well, now we got to pay these people equally. You know, we did that for the benefit of the service because we trusted what you had to say, and we went that way. But we don't want it to come back and bite us and say, well, okay, now you got to do it all the way over here.
I mean, obviously that's one of the concerns that I have to deal with, and, sure. and part of it is, you know, as you well know, in Deerfield we have this very ham-fisted method of determining compensation. I'm hoping that we can...
The compensation thing, and if I'm out of line here, Mr. Chairman, just please go ahead and tell me. It's just that, you know, our compensation study is very, I think it's very complex in how about they go about it. And we had one done, and we kind of rejected it because basically all this person did was go out to 100 towns and see what towns were paying and average it out. And that's not right, because you can't compare one town to another town. It has to do with, you know, what kind of industries they have in the town, you know, how many people they have in their town, you know, where they're located. You know, some towns their services are a lot more. So, you know, we are struggling, but we are working on that.
What else you got there, Zach?
All right. Our new scheduling and employee management software is being rolled out, which is great. So great. Can't tell you how happy everybody is about that. Yankee Candle just gave us a very generous gift. It's their annual public safety gift, so they alternate between the fire and the police and EMS. So they gave us $3,000 this year, which is very generous, and we'll be going back into communication equipment. So we have a lot of old equipment that we've inherited that has, I just have 5 new pagers that are broken on my desk right now that need to be repaired or replaced. So that'll be great. It'll be really great. Let's see. What was that question?
Do you still use pagers?
They look like this.
Oh, okay.
And they talk to us.
They're not what you're thinking.
No. I'm thinking like...
And they're about $500 a pop, but they typically last forever until they don't.
Yeah,
so.
Yep, understood.
All right, facility. We beat that to death. And we'll probably come back to that eventually, I hope. Administration and budget. Let me see. Oh, I did want to mention in here, we've received quite a few donations. Obviously, the Yankee Candle, the $3,000, which is very nice. But also a lot of donations recently, specifically in the name of Richard Baranowski. So I want to thank everybody who donated in his name. We've got a list and thank you cards being made up now. So similar to that, we always, whenever we have these donations, we try to put them back into things that will help the crew members, the employees, do a better job and be safer. So it's either personal safety equipment, like reflective stuff, or communication equipment, things like that. So so we make sure those donations are really going back to help the individuals that are doing the work in the field. So we're grateful for that. We've got the FY18 budget. I've already had to submit capital improvement plan request to the town of Deerfield. They wanted that at the beginning of December. They also want our FY18 budgets by January 1st. I've taken the data we have so far, which is 2.5 years. I think we're getting a pretty good handle on it. There's a couple large questions in the budget I put together. Basically, one is benefits costs. We've got formulas based on, you know, a certain percentage of gross earnings for Social Security and retirement and things like that. Also, health insurance and stuff like that. Typically, I've found over the past years, as I apply these formulas, my numbers are a lot larger than what Barbara's numbers are. So I'm waiting to hear back from Barbara and Brenda about last year's numbers and either what they know the charges will be next year or a better idea from them. I've run into this 2 years in a row now, and I kind of know now that I need to get those numbers from either of them. So the numbers I plugged in are based on my calculations. I expect them to be on the higher than what we'll see.
You had mentioned something that I'm just curious about. I didn't think town employees paid into Social Security. Am I wrong?
They don't. That's true.
Medicare
taxes. Yes. Yeah. Thank you.
Part of when you budget, you know, you're assuming the highest benefit costs. You assume employees are going to take family plans for the ones who are already working for you. And this is where it kind of gets iffy. You know, you ask people, for single people, you know, if they're planning to get married, do they have kids? He can budget out, and then somebody gets married in September and inherits 4 children, and they've gone from a single plan to a family plan, and costs.
You kind of got to go on last year's appropriation after the fiscal year is done for the following.
Right. And even if things change for and a spouse,
it's kind of a hard area to pinpoint.
So. That leads me to another question. So if we're hiring these people who have other full-time jobs, and I'm just going to, this guy works in Northampton, and now he works here full-time, but Deerfield pays 75%, but down in Northampton, they only pay 50%. Now he switches over to our insurance.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, we can't really do anything about that. But
I don't know if we got so many employees that have two full-time jobs. Maybe employees that have a full-time job here and a part-time job somewhere else.
I don't
else.
Know any, but we don't employ anybody that they
do full-time,
full-time job and it's also someplace else. No.
There was one issue last year when we came to budgeting where the town had to fund some extra money for, is it this item exactly? I think Barbara.
It was
this insurance. Item, right? We didn't budget it just right last year, and we had to move some money from reserves, I think it was.
Yeah.
I don't know how you'd exactly pinpoint that year to year. You kind of have to go on the previous years.
It was retirement funding.
Oh, maybe that's what it was.
And we had estimated our retirement funding higher than what it actually was because we estimated it for full-time employees.
That's
and we
right.
We hired a bunch of part-timers.
That's right.
So our allocation was off, therefore,
ended up having to pick
more
it up
of it out of their funding because of the
just the way we estimated it, I think, right? And we're going to look at that this year.
Which is why I'm waiting
yes,
because every time I tried to, I learned the hard way that trying to do that by myself just caused some problems. So, those line items are still up in the air. Like I said, her numbers typically come back lower. And then the other issue is. We still have, and I forget the term because it's not retained earnings, it's revenue over expenses, I think is the term Brenda used for FY16. So this is FY16, mind you, right?
Mm-hmm.
Revenue over expenses, one, because we had some gaps in full-time coverage, two, because we got more revenue than we were expecting, things of that nature. So the We've got the operating reserves that are earmarked, the capital, ambulance capital that's earmarked, and the medical equipment capital that was earmarked, which left, how much did that leave? Around $300,000 of revenue over expenses. So the question is, in what ways do we want to apply that to the FY18 budget?
I have a quick question.
Yeah.
Sorry, but all these figures that you have in parentheses, in my world, anything in parentheses is a negative. Is that what you're meaning to do with this, or just?
Yes, because it's, and this is something I've picked up from Brenda, that if it's
not
revenue,
certified.
It's negative when you're talking about calculating the budget. So, because it's negative against your expenses, because it's.
It's negative because it's not applied, evidently.
All right. Move on. I'm under the barrel. I ain't going to figure this out.
So one of his questions is how you want to apply that. Do you apply a certain amount to the capital and then the rest take it off of the operating budget? That's what was done in the past.
Right. So my three things that I was thinking from my standpoint was the capital, which is ambulance replacement and then IV pumps mandated by the state and the auto load stretcher systems to bring all of our vehicles up to the same level as the new truck. That came to $92,000 for those items. Yes, Kip?
I think I know what I want to say. I don't know. So the new ambulance is going to come with the auto load.
Yes.
So are you saying that you want to buy two auto loads for the older ambulances?
Correct.
But if we're already appropriating money for yet another one, I know it's 3 or 4 years down the road. Why, I mean, we're going to have two ambulances with auto loads. Why do the third one? I mean,
because that ambulance is still the backup for one of the other ambulances. For, and so this way, if the auto loads save employee injuries, they save patient injuries and liability, and I've already considered them to be like great safety equipment. So to bring all the vehicles up to the same thing, only one training modality, only one way that we're
they
doing
are about $40,000.
No. It's about $10,000 a piece, so $20,000 for the pair. Which pays for itself in the first back injury you save. So,
I was on the same page as you. I thought there were 40,000 too.
Well, that's just doing quick math and I divide 90.
So the IV pumps you spend every year, right?
No, so the IV pumps, this is for
new mandate.
Yeah. So the state is requiring IV pumps now, and three pumps we expect to be $21,000. And then the stretcher load system is $10,000 a piece, so $20,000 there.
Those could be taken out of an ambulance.
Absolutely.
Because I look at some of the dollar amounts and
right.
I understand that the vehicles aren't worth much, but
so just like the stretchers, they would be transferred over to an ambulance. Yeah. Yep.
Right. Just, I guess, do something that I would do. When the people that are building our ambulance, there's maybe a good chance that that's where we'll go back for another one. Talk to them and make sure that when they make design changes, not to, you know, screw this up so we can't use it. You know what I'm saying?
Not a problem. So the capital expenses and the other two areas would be offset the town assessments. And then also, it was brought up earlier, do we need to earmark something for outfitting the facility, office furniture, things like that? Should we have money earmarked for that? And if so, how much?
How about the exhaust system for the base? That's pretty expensive.
Yeah. Where are my notes? Mike Rock up at Highland gave me a great tour of his facility, and one of the things he said was the source capture system. I forget. He had a recommendation on which one, and I don't know if I made a note about how much it cost. But I can certainly figure that out for Bill.
Whaley put one in the station, I believe it was around 60 grand.
Yeah, there's also, there's grants available if you have housing at the, if you have 24/7 staffing at your facility, there's grants available for those systems as well. Just because the carcinogens that are in those exhausts and things like that. So that would be hopefully available.
A few years back, I built a commercial garage in Northampton. And what they had was real simple. It was just a little floor-mounted blower, mm-hmm. and it went into a hole in the garage door and had a hose that slipped over the thing. You know, they were $600.
Sure, sure, yeah.
I mean, yeah, you deal with the hose, but no matter what, I mean, you're not going to have the fancy thing to lift it up in the air, but...
Yeah, you know, these systems are designed just like the auto eject, so we plug all of our trucks in to keep all the batteries and the equipment charged. These systems are designed that they attach, they're coupled around the exhaust, and when you start the truck, that they automatically release and they're on track, so that, you know, nobody's tripping over them on the way to the apparatus and things like that. There are competing versions out there. It's not something that I've researched or anything like that, so.
Just a question, where would that be installed?
In the garage.
Which garage?
Where the ambulances are housed.
All the garages would be
No, no, no. This would be in a new facility.
Oh, the new facility will not have such a device?
What?
Exhaust?
Probably not.
Can you build that? A code for that one?
Yep.
Yeah.
I kind of do think we'll...
What was the question?
I was looking at this exhaust system.
Yeah.
It seems like if you're going to build a garage, house diesel-fueled vehicles, you would build it with an exhaust system. Now I'm hearing that we're thinking about purchasing an exhaust system for a building that we're building.
I think it's got to be mandatory. It has to be there. They made us put it in the Whaley station.
That would be my opinion.
You don't have to buy code. But this is where I look at it from. I'm not saying that it's not a good idea to have some sort of setup. The Deerfield Highway Garage has one of these things, and it has monitors in it. And every time they start something up, you get these huge fans that come out, and that's, I don't know how many square feet it is. It's, you know, they want a heated garage. By the time they get that truck out of the garage, it's 20 degrees in there, you know, and then the town spends $150 to get that truck, that building back up to it. Then they come and take another truck out, and the whole process starts all over.
If it's not mandated by the state, then it's probably a requirement of an insurance company, then.
I don't know.
Yeah. We were made to put it, you know, we were told we needed to put it in.
A big fan.
But there's different, you know, I guess like what I was suggesting, Gary, is that you could, you can just have the hose that goes on the exhaust with a blower on it. Yeah, you do have to turn it on manually, but $700 versus 60 grand, you know.
I don't know if you can get away with that. Yeah. I mean, there's something to check into. Anyways.
Well, I don't know about the insurance aspect of it, but as far as the building code or any of those, it's not a requirement.
I was thinking, with all this, I would still think there's got to be a building committee coming together to discuss these type of items that are not part of the building or...
He's right there.
No, I know, but I'm talking to you because we're still going to have to come together because we're going to have to figure out what we're going to have for desks, what we're going to have for all the stuff that make up an EMS building, right?
I would think so.
So we're certainly going to have some people together to figure out whatever doesn't come in the building. Okay, now we're left figuring this out. Whatever
it
wasn't the
one
gift.
Up at one time. We just never.
No kidding.
It was Bobby, Gary, and Matt.
And then it was Kip. He was on it. But we haven't had any meetings yet. I don't know nothing about.
So we still have a building committee?
No, we don't. Because Kip's been our building committee.
I kind of agree with Trevor.
Well, does it sound better coming out of his mouth, or did I say it earlier? And
remember,
Kip
remember,
said, no,
hey,
we don't need one.
Hey, remember our herd blocked.
Just ask Siri if we need one. Turn on your phone.
I can tell you from experience, there's a gentleman in Greenfield who
used office furniture. I think the town has used them before.
Yeah.
And it's not, there were comments made about, don't we have furniture today? The stuff we have in the office today is that press board stuff that wiggles when you work.
Yeah, that's awful.
And we've been kind of waiting on getting something better.
There's another big one down in Hoyoke.
Very good quality at very good prices. So we're going to get a lot better furniture than this press board stuff, something that will last.
There's another one down in Hoyoke, too, that's supposed to be pretty good.
Well, we can certainly check.
I did happen to visit Zach this morning, and I made a comment about it, but I just happened to know a guy where I think I could get a bunch of really nice desks for nothing.
Ah.
It was from the old, I know. I'm just offering help. I mean, sorry, but.
You're just full of information.
Sorry.
Anything else coming before this board tonight? Any new?
No, the only other thing I want to pick on Zach, well, I don't want to pick on him right away. I was just, how many times a year do like EMTs and paramedics have to be recertified or have to go through continuing education? Is it once a year or is it?
They recertify every 2 years. In that recertification, they're required to have it's
40.
40-hour, well, it's a 40-hour recertification course on top of another paramedics, 20 hours of continuing education credits, plus another 8-hour CPR and 8-hour ACLS.
It's torture.
Yeah.
And we have some money set aside for that we haven't spent yet this year, right?
Correct, yes, okay. Because everybody, they're all...
in that cycle.
March 31st is when you expire.
Okay.
Thank you, Massachusetts. And so that means everybody's in the recertification cycle right now. So based on the money that we have allocated, all of our full-time staff get the recertifications covered by the town. And the money that's left over, we figure out who's done so many calls in the last quarter over the span of the year, and the top players get their recertification fees reimbursed.
Years ago under Deerfield EMS, we established a prorated reimbursement so that the guy who showed up on 2 calls a year didn't get his full reimbursement paid for, but if he did 100 calls, he got it paid for.
Makes sense.
And the argument was, same to what you talked about earlier, if they're working for 2 or 3 services,
right,
and only do 2 from you, they're going to give you a bill knowing they've been paid elsewhere.
Right.
And we had an idea who worked elsewhere, who was being paid for, and people were generally pretty good about it.
Yeah.
If there was anything that we had.
Well, it also jumps substantially about 10 years ago from like $20 up to $150.
Yeah, and we're talking about the people who aren't employed full-time with an agency somewhere else. You know, these are our local EMTs who are responding to calls and covering shifts.
Yep. Bruce?
I know the budget's almost expended for this fiscal year, pretty close.
Huh?
Or
what?
Training.
Oh, for training.
Oh. Yes, training. That is because it's contracted services.
So is that part of the recertification? No, that's a different budget.
He does
Teaches
a recertification.
The training is for the contracted services. He covers a lot of those continuing education credits. We call them letter cards. So anything you'd get from like the Red Cross, your CPR, your advanced cardiac life support certifications, we have to pay for those and the recertification fees to the state. And we're talking about $250 to $300 per person. That's the training versus the recertification line items.
So if most of the people get recertified this year, they won't have to be recertified next year.
Correct.
That way your budget will be much less next year.
The recertification part would be less. The training will still be the same because you're still, they've got to continue
it.
And the recertification is not everybody's on the same 2 years. It depends.
That's right.
Yeah, so it's like I'm recertifying this year, but the person next to me isn't. So, yeah.
Zach, this printout that you gave me, is that that new software?
That is the new one, yeah. I wouldn't have been able to do that in the old one, so you're welcome.
Does David still do that scheduling?
The day-to-day approvals going through.
He does.
Like individual going through and making and approving shifts. But overall scheduling I still handle.
And the town of Deerfield does the actual payroll for your service. You don't have, I did see somewhere in here, it said something about payroll service.
Yes.
We're allocated cost from
Harper,
the town.
Harper payroll.
Barbara, yeah, Barbara pays for payroll.
Yep.
And then we're allocated our portion of whatever Harper's cost is for.
So this company, Harper's, actually does the prints the checks and stuff?
Do they print the checks?
They
were service that manages it. We tell them how many hours and they calculate the pay, the taxes.
Yeah. This is a town of Deerfield thing.
They pay the taxes and or allocate the right amount of taxes.
And
yeah. Yeah. Yes.
All right. Well,
yes.
Then that brings me to my next question is that Sarah, who does the paperwork with Brenda, keep complaining about the paperwork is all messed up.
Yeah.
It takes them a while. Now, that's where I was getting it. Does that come from David or does it come from this Harper's place?
So that is because our old scheduling system doesn't do what we need to is broken. Right now, individuals submit their time cards. And when we have things like shift differentials and on-call shifts at $8 an hour versus callbacks at their full rate, those things, so somebody submits their timesheet, David then collects those, reviews them, and bundles them together. And in a lot of that, little things are missed. Sarah has to manually enter all of those pay sheets,
right,
which is a nightmare, right? So this new system, in the very least, computes all these things automatically. It's all electronic time cards. Nobody has to submit their own handwritten time cards anymore and will generate a report for Sarah.
Yep.
Optimally, and this is a question for whether Barbara and Sarah can accommodate this, our system can output to Harper's software or whatever they're using automatically. Okay. So there's no data entry on their end if they choose to go that route.
And my last thing is, you guys can pass this down. I've asked several times about this. This is an application to the USDA to get $93,000 back for that ambulance. So I'd like you to do it up and send it in. I put the guy's name and phone number there. And if you have any issues, you can go right down to Hadley and they'll walk you right through it.
That's great. This is the first I'm getting the application, though. I did speak with the Whately Town Administrator who followed up on this and stated that if the money's already been spent or something's already been signed, then it's not going to work and we have to do it for the next one.
This is the problem when you get information secondhand, thirdhand. I go through this all the time. When we had a town administrator, ask a question, he'd call council, and by the time I got it back, it was like, that's not even what I was talking about.
Okay.
You know,
he'll call him up.
Yeah, call him up. And what it is that if they don't have money, if the feds don't have the money right now, you still put the application in, and when that money comes in, even though we buy the ambulance and we pay for the ambulance, you can get that portion of the grant money back, and it can be as high as $93,000. So it's worth
to take.
Yeah.
Or in a couple of years, you might be in line to be buying another one, the next one.
And also something that I don't know if it's to any benefit, but the same program will finance these things. So, you know, I don't know, I'm still learning all this, but if it's better for the towns, you know, instead of, you know, putting this money into it, you can finance it for less than 1%, and then you just allocate the money for the annual payments. Is that how you do it? So
I think they're trying to do something with our fire truck with the USDA.
So with this new software, less work for the administrative part of Deerfield, so we get a reduced cost on that? Just asking.
Checks in the mail. It'll be here for Christmas. Do I hear a motion? Oh, did you have something to say?
He wants to get out of here.
You've spoke enough tonight, Tom.
I think I said enough.
Motion?
Motion.
Second.
Motion.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Merry Christmas.
Happy New Year.
Christmas.
Merry Christmas.